Hello friends, this is Shashank. I hope you all are doing well today. So today we'll be going to cover up another important topic from AWS, which is how to do a load balancing in AWS cloud. Again, this is something you deal with your day-to-day routine, with your staging and production environment where you provision number of servers and try to figure out how to spread the traffic across the servers using some load balancing method. So first of all, let's try to understand the concept and what are the offerings we have from AWS, followed by a practical demo. I have tried to cover up the theoretical part from a short presentation. Let's review this first to understand the concept. So load balancing, by name it suggests to balance a load. Load is something your traffic request coming from the internet or intranet to the hosted application or web servers. Let's say we have two servers hosted our website example.com. And I can see website is getting millions of hits across the world. So obviously deploying an application to one server would never be a wise decision, as that will choke up the CPU or memory at any point of time. And even if that server goes down, website will go down, affecting millions of the subscriber. So to manage this, what solution we can apply for, right? One of the solution is load balancing by appending more servers and distribute the traffic across the servers based upon the algorithm that load balancing tools provide, right? So with this diagram, the same thing is happening. We have a website hosted on two application server 1 and 2, which are behind my load balancer. And this load balancer can be anything like F5, or we can have AWS load balancer as well. So user is hitting a website which is public hosted website, and again this can be internet, this can be intranet, there is no restriction on that, we can apply both. So user is hitting a website which is passing via internet coming to my load balancer, and at load balancer we have certain level of algorithm provided. Either it can be round robin, which is by default algorithm that we have on load balancer, or it can be least algorithm, it can be cookie based as well. So that totally depends. There are like number of algorithms that get provided by load balancing tool. So by default it gets round robin, so based upon that it will gonna route the traffic to the application servers. So let's say if we are getting millions of hits on a website, then that hit will gonna go to load balancer, and behind that load balancer we have number of servers, right, facing or hosting that application. So whichever the servers are free, round robin algorithm based upon my load balancer will gonna route the traffic across the number of servers. In this way, even if one server goes down, my application will still available to the user from another servers. So that is the best part of load balancing. So we have number of load balancing tool present in our market. One of the famous one is BigIP F5, which is from Verizon. You're gonna find F5 as a load balancing tool in most of the companies. Then we have Elastic Load Balancing from Amazon, which provides like three level of categories inside our load balancer. Let's review that. So Elastic Load Balancer automatically distributes the incoming traffic across multiple targets. So let's say you are a user hitting a website which is hosted on Amazon cloud, then the request which is coming from the user will hit the Elastic Load Balancer, and based upon the level of load balancing we are using, whether it is application, network or classic, it will gonna route the request to the target servers. So target would be like your Amazon EC2 instances, containers, IP addresses or Lambda functions. It will gonna automatically distribute the traffic. Okay. It can handle the varying load of your application traffic within a single availability zone, or it can do load balancing across multiple availability zone. If you want to do a load balancing across region, we can use Route 53. So Elastic Load Balancing offers three type of load balancer with all the features of high availability, automatic scaling, robust security necessary to make your application fault tolerant. So one of the best part of Elastic Load Balancing that it will scale up automatically based upon the number of requests coming to your load balancer, and it's highly available in nature. So the three type of load balancer we have from Amazon is application load balancer, network load balancer, and classic load balancer. So application load balancer is best suited to balance the load of HTTP and HTTPS traffic. So this is the layer 7 load balancer. It operates at layer 7 of your OSI model, which is your application tier. So basically it provides the advanced request routing target at delivery of your modern application architecture. Application load balancer routes the traffic to the target with Amazon Virtual Cloud based upon the content of the request. So let's say we have everything created in our VPC. So VPC is again our networking data center where we design all our subnets, internet gateway, NAT gateway, and route tables, right? So as part of that, we have created number of application servers, the Amazon EC2 instances, and we have hosted some sort of application over there, like example.com. So those servers are considered as target. So whenever requests will come to the load balancer, application load balancer will gonna route the request to all other target servers. Okay. So one of the best advantage of using application load balancer that it provides us path-based routing. It provides us host-based routing as well. Okay. Next one is network load balancer. So network load balancer is operates basically at layer 4 of your OSI model, which is your network layer. Okay. Which is best suited for balancing the TCP, UDP, and transport layer, TLS traffic, where extreme performance is required. Okay. So application load balancer operates at layer 7. Network load balancer operates at layer 4. So application load balancer, it's HTTP and HTTPS traffic. Network load balancer is TCP, UDP, or TLS traffic. Okay, operating at layer 4, routes the traffic to the target within VPC, and it's capable of handling millions of requests per second while maintaining ultra low latency. So the latency wise, the performance wise, we are good in terms of either you use application load balancer or network load balancer. Both are highly available in nature. Only the layer of service that they provide is different. Application works at application layer, which is layer 7. Network works at layer 4, which is network layer. The next one is classic load balancer. So classic load balancer was the first one which was introduced by Amazon. This is one of the oldest, and I guess in next few years this will gonna get obsolete for sure. So classic load balancer provides a basic load balancing across multiple EC2 instances, operates at both request and connection level. Classic load balancer is intended for the application that were built within EC2 classic network. Okay. So with this particular tutorial, I'll gonna cover up the demo of application load balancer and classic load balancer. The next video will be based totally on the network load balancer. So let's review some advantages of application load balancer over classic load balancer. Because whenever you create classic load balancer, you will gonna get an option to migrate it over application load balancer. As I said, the application load balancer supports path-based routing. It can be host-based routing as well. So while we configure the application load balancer, we're gonna see number of options that we get to route the request to the targets. It supports routing based on the field in the request, such as your standard and custom HTTP headers and methods, query parameters, and source IP addresses. Then we have custom HTTP response. We get returning custom HTTP response as well. We can redirect the request from one URL to another URL. The performance is quite improved from classic load balancer. You can configure your logging of load balancer to S3 bucket as well. Then it supports the containerized application as well from Amazon ECS, which is another different topic which we'll gonna cover in next few videos. Then it supports the registering of the Lambda functions as well as a target. It supports the registering of the target by IP addresses, including targets outside the VPC for the load balancers. So these are a few benefits that we have of application load balancer over classic load balancer. So I hope the concept-wise load balancing technique is quite clear for you guys. Next video will be coming up on network load balancer in detail. So let's do a practical demo for classic load balancer and application load balancer with this particular tutorial. For that, let's jump to our AWS management console. So this is my AWS management console. So if I go to my EC2 instances, I have already provisioned two Linux instances, which is running with Apache and having an index.html file. So I'll show you that. Let's copy this, open my Chrome. This is my web server 1, which is returning a value welcome to server 1. And I'll show you the another web server as well. This will gonna return web server 2. So I'll be using these two servers to provision our load balancers. So to create load balancer, you can go to load balancer, which is on the left hand side of EC2 dashboard. Click on load balancer. Now, as of now, I don't have any load balancer in my Northern Virginia. And again, load balancers are region specific. So let's create a one. This will present us three options: application, network, and classic. As you can see, classic is previous generation. And the advanced version, I would say, it's the application load balancer. So let's create classic load balancer first. Give this name as test classic load balancer. I have only one VPC, which is default. So that's why I have to select that one. Now, if you select this option, internal load balancer, this will act as your intranet load balancer, which is like within your network, you will be able to provision this. Now click on advanced. This will gonna present us with certain options like number of subnets. So we have to select at least 2 subnets. You can see, please select at least 2 subnets in a different availability zone to provide higher availability of load balancer. So now the best part, classic load balancer also supports SSL termination at load balancer. So what does that mean? So let's say you have a SSL certificate implemented for your application, which is hosted in Amazon. Now you want to encrypt your traffic, which is like coming from public till your load balancer. And you don't want to encrypt your traffic from load balancer to the target instance, which is achievable using my classic load balancer. How can we do that? So here is an option where you can select HTTPS. So this part will be acting as your public. So after your load balancer, everything will be encrypted in nature. And once it comes to my internal network, like to the server, the target server, the traffic will not be encrypted in nature. So I have worked with one of an organization where we have followed this particular requirement, where we have encrypted all our traffic on the public network, and while coming internal to our servers, the traffic was unencrypted in nature. So that is something supported by classic load balancer. I don't have any certificate, so I'm using HTTP. So my public will be 80 and the internal will be 80 as well. Now we have to select subnets. So let's go to our EC2 instance. Let's see where we have created our servers. I guess that should be 2 availability zone, but just cross checking. Web server 2 is in 1A, web server 1 is in 1C. Great. So let's select 1A and 1C. Okay. Next, you can tighten up your security as well. For this particular video, I'm just opening everything on the public network, which is public traffic. Again, it's totally depend upon the requirement. You can tighten up your security of load balancer using security group. Next, configure security settings. So you can see like there's a suggestion, improve your load balancer security. Your load balancer is not using secure listener because we are not using SSL certificate and I don't have that. So that's why I'm using 80. Next, configure health check. So this option will gonna ping your index.html file every 5 seconds. every interval of 30 seconds. And this will poke up your instances, like whether your instance is healthy or not. If instance is not healthy, then request will not gonna hit that particular server. Add EC2 instances. So this is the place where you add your target servers. Now you have to select web server 1 and web server 2. Connection training is 300 seconds. So basically number of seconds that allow existing traffic to continue flowing. So till 300 seconds, one session, or sorry, till 300 seconds, my connection will gonna go to one server, then after that, another server. So it's just like acting as a sticky sessions. Enable cross zone load balancing, which we are doing as of now. We are in 1C and 1A. Next is tagging. Again, tagging is quite important during the auditing purpose. So I would say test classic load balancer, review and create. This is the review section. Just hit create button. Your test CLB was successfully created. Let's click on this. Now you can see we have all the options. We get the DNS. So whenever AWS creates a load balancer, it creates a record and gives us a alias name. Okay, this is the alias that we have. Test CLB, then an ID, US East 1, ELB, Amazon, AWS.com. And you can see, as I said, during the theoretical part, we have been given an option to migrate classic to application load balancer, okay? Which is the next generation load balancer. Then we are getting a hosted zone. This is the VPC status, it's not in service. Then port configuration is 8080, security group, then all the health checks. You can configure your access log as well. Now go to the instances. As you can see, it's still out of service. Let's click on this part. Instance registration is still in progress. So this will gonna take some time, let's say a minute to two, to get everything properly in sync with all these services. And you can do like, you can, if you want to remove one of your web server, you can do it from here as well. Health check. We are doing health check. Ping target is index.html for HTTP traffic on 80. We are having listeners 8080 port. Then we can do monitoring as well, like unhealthy host, healthy host, latency, and the request count basically. Tagging that we have done, migration, which we are getting to launch an ALB. So I'm gonna show you both how to create ALB and I'm gonna migrate this load balancer to ALB as well. So let's go to instance. Now you can see both the servers are in service. Now let's try to copy the A record and hit it on browser. Let's hit this, enter. So we are getting first response from web server 2. Let's hit one more time. I just want to see if we are getting response from server 1 or not. So based upon the round robin algorithm, it's routing my traffic to server 1 and server 2. Okay, so this is the way that how you create classic load balancer and how you do the health checks basically. Now the next part is to create my application load balancer, how we can do that. So my best practices to follow is like whenever I create load balancer, which is application in nature, then I create target group first. Again, here you get two options like internal facing and internet facing. Internal is like your internet environment, that what we have seen with classic. The IP address type is dual stack and IPv4. Dual stack is something IPv4 and 6 as well. Then protocol, here we are not getting SSL termination option. It's like one protocol in nature. Then the VPC availability zones that we have to select, then configure the security group. So let's try to create target group first. I follow that as a best practices. So let's create a target group. So target group is just below our load balancer. Let's create this. Test ALB. Instance. So we have three type of target: instance, IP, and Lambda function. You can select any of these. Protocol is 80. This is the VPC that we have. Let's scroll it down a bit. Then the health check, which is index.html. Here we have two options of protocol. If we'll be using certificate, then I'll be using HTTPS. Then advanced health check is traffic port and override. Again, since we are using index.html, that is like directly hitting the page, then I'll be using 200. If it is getting redirected to some other URL, then you have to use 302, like comma 302. So we are not using that. So let's create our target group first. Now, we have to associate target over here. How can you do that? So go to the target, edit, and you have to select both the servers, add to register, and click save. Now, the status is showing unused. Target group is not configured to receive a traffic from load balancer because we haven't created a load balancer as of now. So let's go to our load balancer, create load balancer, hit on create for application load balancer. Now, test ALB is my load balancer name. This is internet facing HTTP. Availability zone should be 1A and 1C. Next, configure the security group. So I'll be using public for this particular tutorial. Configure the routing. Now, obviously, I don't want to, you can create target group from here as well, or you can use the existing one, which we have created. Again, that is my best practices where I create target group first and then I go ahead and create my application load balancer. Rest of the settings has been already done for the target group. So register the targets, which is 8080, review, and create. So you can see like successfully created a load balancer, test ALB, discover the other services, visit integrated tabs and all. So let's close this and select test ALB. Now, here again, we are getting DNS name, which is test ALB. This is the ID, then US East 1, ELB, Amazon, AWS.com. State is still provisioning. This will gonna take like, again, 1 to 2 minutes to get active in nature. This is internet facing, availability zone, then the hosted zone, security groups. And you can do these settings like delete protection. If you enable it, you own this protects like from accidental deletion. You can have HTTP2 support as well. You can enable your logging. You can create on S3 bucket. So I'll not be using that as of now because I don't have anything in my instances, just a plain index.html file. If you go to the listener, so this looks quite different from classic load balancer. So the listener ID is HTTP80. And if you edit the rule, this will gonna show you request otherwise not routed, forward this request to test ALB. Let's edit this. So this is the edit option. Now, edit this one. You can see if all match, target is test ALB. Test ALB, this is the target group that we have created where we have two servers present, right? Now, if you want to add something, click on add, insert rule. Let's see what other option we are getting. With the help of host header, you can write it like your domain name, FQDN basically, and you can route this request to forward this to or redirect or return a fixed response. You can do these things. Forward is something, the test ALB, you have to give the target name. Then the other option that we have, let's cancel this. Path-based routing, you can give the path as well, and you can again route this request to these three. Let's close this as well. HTTP header, HTTP request method, query string, and the source IP. So these are the options that we are getting with application load balancer. So whenever you want to create number of target groups, so let's say you want to have only one application load balancer, and within that environment, let's say if it's a customer onboarding environment, You can have one application load balancer and you can create number of target groups, and you can route the request to all the other target groups. So one target group will not get affected with the others. Okay. So it's active now. So this will gonna take some time. So let's try to hit this. If we are getting a response or not. Yes, we are getting. We'll try to refresh this. This is the second web server that we are getting a response. So that means our application load balancer is working fine. Okay. Now, the next step is to migrate, to show you the how to migrate the classic load balancer. So go to classic load balancer, click on migrate now. This will gonna ask you to launch ALB migration wizard. Click on this. You don't have to do anything over here. This will gonna create another load balancer with naming convention as test CLB with all the same configuration. You can see the highlighted field below indicate new values in green and original in gray. So this is the success code that we are getting. These are the two instances. Now, when you hit create, this will gonna create a test CLB as internet facing application load balancer. So whatever we have done with the manual stuff with application load balancer, you don't have to do it when you try to migrate from classic load balancer to application load balancer. So if I hit create, this will gonna say everything is created successfully. You can hit close and there will be one additional entry will be there, test CLB. Let's wait for that. Test CLB. You can see status is provisioning. The listeners are over here. The test CLB, if you hit test CLB as a target group, if you go to targets, these two are getting initialized. So everything during the migration, everything is added by default with this particular ALB wizard. So you don't have to do anything manual. You don't have to create load balancer. You don't have to create target group. If you are migrating, again, remember, if you are migrating from your classic load balancer to application load balancer, you just have to click migrate now and click create. That's it. So this is the way that we used to create our application load balancer, classic load balancer. So I hope this clears a lot on how to use load balancer. The next video is coming up on network load balancer. That is another topic whole together. So I just want to cover that as a separate one. So just try to create a load balancer on your account. Try to create on your staging environment. Have two servers, whether it is Windows or Linux. If it is Windows, then it will be an IIS. If it is Linux, you can use Apache, Tomcat, or any other web service, right? Or application server. Try to create load balancer, see whether your request is getting routed properly or not. And if you're facing any issue while creating a load balancer, just place out a comment in comment section. I'll be there to help you right away. Have a nice day. Bye-bye.